think of selfishness, we have to recognize that selfishness comes from greed, right? Selfishness is wanting something for yourself. And of course, when you think selfishness comes from greed, then you think, well, where does greed come from? And greed would come from not having something that you want, right? Or wanting it for yourself so that nobody else can have it. And I think when you're thinking of where greed comes from the fact that you are lacking something, which means you don't have something that you do want. And so if you follow that trail, at the end of that trail comes the reality that you and I, we are selfish and we are greedy because we are lacking something. And so you see that when people want power or fame or money or any of that kind of stuff is because they don't have it, but they want it, or they want more of it. And either way, it boils down to not having something. But then when we look at God, we realize that he has everything he needs. In fact, God doesn't need anything or anyone. Before God created the world, you would be right in saying that God was perfectly happy and content in and of himself with the other two persons of the Trinity. He didn't have to create anything because he was lacking anything. He already has everything he wants. So when God commands us in Scripture to worship and praise him and give him glory and that kind of stuff, it doesn't come from a desire out of lacking something. He doesn't need it desperately for people to do him to make him feel good or anything like that. So, but he does nonetheless, he does command us to praise and worship him. So a good question is then why? If God doesn't need us to, if he doesn't need that to fulfill something in him that he's lacking, why does God command us to worship and praise him? And to answer this, I'd like to read, it's a bit of a lengthy passage, but we're just going to look at one today. And I'm going to read the beginning of the book of Ephesians. So I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to pull out a couple things. And we're going to see two reasons why God would command us to worship and praise him. So I'm going to start in verse 3 of Ephesians. It says this: "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood for the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be fulfilled or to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory." So these verses tell us twice that God does all of these things for the praise of his glory. In other words, to give him glory. So the first thing I want to look at is why God does this. I made a list of all of the things in this passage that God has done for you and me. So the first reason is because God deserves our worship. Here's a quick list, and I literally did this in like 2 minutes, and so you could dig down deeper and find even more. But think of this. God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. He's chose Christians to be with Christ. He makes us holy. He makes us blameless. He's predestined us out of his love. He makes us his children through Christ. He gives us grace freely. He's given us redemption, which means to be made right with God through Jesus' blood. He's given us forgiveness again through Jesus. He's lavished his grace on us. He's made known to us the mystery of his will. He's chosen us to be Christians according to his plan. And having believed, we are marked with a seal, which is the Holy Spirit, and this guarantees our inheritance in heaven. It guarantees that we will be with him. So thinking of all of those things that are just in this one passage, God deserves our worship. Has anyone you know done this stuff for you? And keep in mind, all of these things are done for people who don't deserve it. And I've said many times in youth that we as humans have many times we've basically, in one way or another, spat in God's face and told them, you don't deserve to be God, I want to be God. And this is deserving of punishment. It's deserving of hell. But God, in his love for us, has done all of those things that I've just mentioned from that list. And in fact, again, this is just from one passage in the whole Bible. If you read the whole thing, you'll come up with an immeasurable list of all the stuff that God has done for you and for me to a people who don't deserve it. So one, God deserves our praise and worship because he deserves it. He asked for it. He tells us to worship him because he's the only one who's done this stuff for us. And without him doing this, you and I would be in hell forever and ever. It's not a place I want anyone to be with, but anyone to be. And so I would take a moment right now to tell you that if you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, look at all the things that Jesus has done for you, that God has done for you. And so I would say, accept him as your Savior, make him the Lord of your life and live for him and realize the love that God has shown you in Christ Jesus. So number one, he tells us to worship and follow him and to give him praise and glory because he deserves it. But also, number two, he commands us to give him praise and glory for the reason that God wants the best for his people. So think of it this way. God wants the best for us. He loves us, as we've just read. He loves us immeasurably. You have no idea how much God loves you. He loves you more than you can possibly imagine. And because he loves you more than you can possibly imagine, he loves his people. He wants the best for them. God never does anything for his people that's bad for them. He never does. Okay, he only has good for his people. And if he wants the best for his people, then he has to point them to the most glorious, best thing. And the most glorious, best thing is God himself. If there was something more joyful, more satisfying, more glorious than God, then God, because of his love for us, would point us to that thing. But there's nothing. There's nothing more glorious and joyful than God. And so because God is the top of glorious, he points us to himself. And so in this way, it's good for us to worship God. It's actually for our benefit. Worshiping God is the highest possible joyful and satisfying thing you could imagine. We often think of sin as being satisfying. And the reality is that sin might be a little satisfying for a short amount of time. And that's why it draws us in, right? But when we do what God wants us to do, when we worship him, when we glorify him, when we praise him, it's not just a little satisfaction for a short amount of time. It's an immeasurable amount of satisfaction for an immeasurable amount of time. Now, you and I as sinners, we can't fully understand this on earth because we still struggle with sin. But anybody who's believed in Christ Jesus for the forgiveness of their sins will be with Christ one day and will realize this, will actually see this and experience this, that worshiping God is for our highest good because God deserves it and because there's nobody higher and more glorious and joyful than God. And so he has to point us to himself. And so we see that God's glory, and he commands us to worship him because it is the best thing for his people, and you will not find more joy and satisfaction in worshiping anything or anybody else than Jesus Christ.